Can I comment on that real quick? And this will be my opportunity to double down against my friend Aaron. I think like for YouTube, what I was saying about that is that YouTube is not the best place for you to do like narrative scripted content that tells an ongoing story over the course of many episodes, right? So in terms of like a show like Lady Tips, for example, like that format being so like instructional and informational is not the right word, but you know what I mean, like that kind of presentational format could work on YouTube. But really the thing you need to start with is the audience. Like I agree with Darren, you wouldn't go through the merch thing until you have the scale of the audience. Oh sure, yeah.
I was asking what. It sounded like you're answering what platform is best to put your content on. I think what I was asking is considering your own creative vision as a platform in its own right. And so if you have a great idea for a show, that's great. But what people are buying is the bigger brand vision behind your actual show. Like, how can we take your show and turn it into something that will actually generate a lot of revenue from a lot of different vectors? You know, so something like Game of Thrones has houses that fight against each other. So suddenly people get into that area. Or maybe like personal narratives, like girls, where people totally get personally invested. So when people say these big companies, like, well, we're buying the bigger brand vision, we're buying the platform that comes out of your creative idea, like, what are those core elements of your idea and turning it into a platform that then becomes, like, merchandise is just an example, but how can it grow bigger than just like your one idea, if that makes sense?
Yeah, I mean, so Game of Thrones is on HBO, right? Like, that's your, like, let's start there, right? Like, no, but seriously, like, that's the platform. It is actually made for that platform. It was adapted for that, and it was adapted for a very specific medium. YouTube is the same. Like, there's a very specific medium that works on YouTube. There's a very specific medium that works on Vimeo. We also own Vimeo, by the way. And I would say the thing with them is that they are, the staff pick is like the only thing for them. Like, they have no other really monetizable thing. Vimeo is more for like, hey, I want to show this producer my thing, and you know, I don't want it on YouTube, so that he can see it, only 50 people saw it, whatever. So that's what Vimeo is used for. I think in terms of like taking that, it has to start platform first. Like, there would be no Game of Thrones stuff if HBO hadn't bought that show. Like, if Game of Thrones was a YouTube show, it wouldn't have the same scope, and that's a money thing. It's also a format thing. I think the better example is, like, as much as you might hate it, like, this stuff like, I don't know, Rhett and Link, or like Fred, you know, that Fred guy, or like the Annoying Orange things, like the things that are like franchises that are born out of YouTube. Like, those are, and honestly, like, that came out of, like, they did it consistently. That's the hardest part for YouTube. It's like, yeah, you have to not only do these great, funny episodes, but you have to do them every week, and they can't feel like they're not hyper-current. You just gotta keep doing it. And once you do that, everything that falls into place after that is the industry that Hollywood is already really good at, which is, okay, now that this is a bankable thing and we crossed that magical 1 million subscriber mark, now we know how to make money out of this. So as far as you worry about your brand, I would say, like, the thing you worry about is just, like, are you getting across the creative vision 100%? Because that's all we care about is, like, the execution. And of course, how many people watch the execution.
Does anybody else have a question?
Hi, so I just have a little bit more of a simple question. About how did a show like Broad City or Insecure, and specifically like its narrative content, because we've been talking a lot about how narrative content is not ideal for YouTube, and I feel like I'm really tuned into YouTube, so I think I understand that. But how did a show like those two shows use their online presence to their advantage to end up getting signed or picked up by bigger networks?
Yeah, I'm very familiar with these two shows because I'm one of those ones. So they have very different stories, and Broad City began as they posted videos on YouTube. It was a small little show. It never really became a big YouTube show, but. Yeah, so that's what happened. They were members of UCB, which is Upright Citizens Brigade in New York City, which is Amy Poehler's theater, and they somehow got their series to Amy and asked her if she would guest star in an episode, which she agreed to do, and then she loved them, and then those two girls and Amy co-developed the pilot that was eventually sold. So that is one way that you get a television show, is that you're amazing and you're talented and you have a great idea and you have a great voice, but you partner with somebody that television believes is a television entity. Issa was a completely different trajectory, in which she created a YouTube series called Awkward Platform, which actually became a very, very popular YouTube phenomenon, but it became a popular YouTube phenomenon because it was a meme, essentially. There wasn't really anything like that voice online, on television certainly, but even online. And there were a lot of African American women that were like, I'm not the girl that's on television all the time, and I have a completely different voice and identity. And so that, she spoke to something that was not represented, and she also created a meme that people would want to buy the shirt. People actually connected with that. And she was very smart, where she understood that she sparked something online, and she continued to produce and create other web series, and she built a whole online business and focused on her online business for many years. She then was able to get a deal with Shonda Rhimes at one point, and then she eventually, years and years later, and if you Google Issa Rae, there's a great article she wrote about how long it took. It took years to get that show on HBO. Yeah, and then she was able to eventually get a show on HBO because she had proven herself as a voice that had an audience. So there are two completely different trajectories, and that's why I was saying earlier that you kind of have to figure out what you're bringing to the table and approach your content and distribution that way. Because at this point, you may likely be self-distributing, and you just have to be smart about it.
Is there anyone else who has a question? Elena, do you have something you want to add? Since you produced the comments, and it's been quite a success on YouTube. I'm going to make her sit here because she created this damn thing. She is incredible. I mean, this is her first web series, 2017. It's going to happen again next year, and it's going to keep growing. Webfest, sorry. I'm exhausted, you're all exhausted. But go ahead and tell us how you started Click On This, and what you were talking about, social media, all the tags.
I can hear you.
I started Click On This in 2001. As a kind of a show that would come on market. I had one of my next series called Life After Issa, and then I went to the series. It was a bit funny. So I pulled a Click On This as a way to talk to sponsors, but it ended up becoming a lifestyle show that's around and just because of the story and the stories. But in 1998, I created a show called Jamie's Way, and I did four episodes with a team member. And so I've been inspired by web series since I first saw Scott Zorkin's web series called The Spot. It was in 1986. I did the Jamie's Way. I've always worked as a crew member. As I've been a crew member, I was able to bring kind of both worlds, the internet world, and I was able to watch the internet world grow, but also the crew world, you know, the television world. I wanted to join in the web festival and really help to promote web series and really fight against the neutrality, keeping the neutrality, fight against and keeping the neutrality. And I wanted to promote you guys, and that's why I created all of these web festivals.
So I guess we are coming to an end on this, but I really want to give her another set of applause, because she did not sleep last night editing a bunch of stuff. stuff for this, and she's just been going 24/7, so she's gonna sleep by tonight. But we thank her for this opportunity, for all of you to be here and support each other. From the questions, from our experience, there is no right answer. We're not big industry in LA. We don't have access to a lot of people with money. Sometimes we don't have access to people with facial recognition. And it's that cycle with that one web series where they latched on to two women that have facial recognition. And so they draw people. Other people see them and are willing to put money in because they'll sell it. Just don't give up. There's no easy answer. It's a combination of everything. But all these people are from different locations around the country, and they're making it work. It's hard as hell, but you can do it. You can do it. So give your all, pat yourself on the back, give yourself a round of applause. Next year, you may have more to show us.